Hello everyone, this is part 5 of the presentation on P2P network.
So we already seen the P2P network, its different architectures, and we started our discussion on case study, and particularly we saw how this Nutella network is working. Then as an improvement to this Nutella network, P2P network, we suggested this structured P2P, and let's have a look at that to get a flavor of structured P2P. Just I'm giving you a brief idea about it. So structured P2P networks, unstructured overlay, that just like what we seen, that is Nutella, employ trivial overlay construction and maintenance algorithm, but the best they can offer is unreliable random search. And you know, as the nodes are joining and leaving the network randomly, that maintenance wise the construction, everything is just trivial only, and they are not taking much effort on it. Because of that trivial construction, they are getting some benefits, but at the same time, and they are offering only unreliable random search only. As you are doing random search, there is no guarantee of getting the result. Or if you are doing a pure query flooding kind of thing, that will lead to exponential search time. Okay, that is the situation. So in contrast, structured overlays are designed to conform to a particular graph structure. The term itself, there is a typical graph structure you can see, that allows reliable and efficient, that is probabilistically bounded delay, object location. So we can locate the object in a reliable way, in an efficient way, and with a probabilistically bounded delay, we can locate the objects. In return for additional complexity during overlay construction and maintenance. So that is a difficulty here. When it comes to Nutella, they are not putting any effort for overlay construction and maintenance. They are just following the trivial approach. But the random search, and it is resulting into unreliable and random search. But here you can ensure a reliable and efficient way of locating the object. But there will be an additional complexity while constructing the overlay and placing the resources, and of course for the maintenance part. And typically here one approach is a kind of mapping between the peer and the resources that the peer is containing. Now that is one of the popular methodology that we can apply in a structured P2P. And in such a scenario, how do we map objects into node? You know, that mapping, the best way you can follow is a typical hash function. So while traditional P2P network, that is what we discussed so far, have no control over which node host object X, in which node particular object X is available, there is no such information kept in that. So if we could control how objects are getting distributed over the network, we might be able to do a better job of finding those objects at a later time. So at the initial time, whenever you are keeping objects into different, or you are distributing objects into different peers, just have a control over it. And that will help you laterly when you are doing the search. So construction wise, we have some complexity, but we are getting the benefit of efficient searching. A well-known technique for mapping names into addresses, here object name into address, that is machine address of the node, which is or the peer which is hosting that object. That mapping, one of the well-known technique is to use a hash table. Just like a hash of X is giving you a value n, that means, which implies object X is first placed on node N. So depending on the value that is given by the hashing function, you are going to place the object. And at a later time, a client trying to locate X would only have to perform the hash of X to determine that it is on node N. So initially, whenever you are keeping object into nodes, you are applying the hash function. So what is the value returned by the hash? And that hash value, we can do a kind of mapping from that hash value to the IP address of that particular machine, say, and you keep that object into that machine. Now, during that, whenever you are trying to search that object, you are trying to locate that object, apply the same hash function, and what is the value given by it will be the address of the machine where that particular object is available. So searching is very efficient now. So what we discussed is a straightforward hashing technique, but when you are using just a simple modular based hashing like what we see in now, there are certain problems and how we can overcome it. So a hash based approach has the nice property that it tends to spread the object evenly across the set of nodes. Just like apply the hash function accordingly, distribute the object over the nodes. So that can be done nicely, but the straightforward hashing algorithm suffer from a fatal flaw. That is, how many possible values of n should we allow? Because we will see, means we have to prefix the value of n. Accordingly, we can continue our hashing. That n is nothing but how many buckets in a typical hash hashing data structure, you know, in a hash function, how many buckets or how many slots are there in the hashing table. Just like that, here our slots are nothing but the machines. So the number of machines is n, and that value you should know in advance. That is a problem, but we know we are following, we need that dynamic membership, like dynamically nodes will be adding and leave the network, and that's in during that time, how you will be managing it. Just take an example. Namely, we could decide that there are, say, 101 possible hash value. Just an example, we are assuming that there are 101 different hash value or 101 machines are there for the time being. And we use a modular function. A typical hash function is modular. And if you are using such a function, hash of x will be giving you a value x mod 101. That is a remainder of division by 101. And you know, when you are taking any number and you are taking the remainder with 101, you will be getting values from 0 to 100. That means you are getting 101 different values. Accordingly, you can distribute the object into 101 different machines also. Unfortunately, if there are more than 101 nodes willing to host object, means when you start your construction, there are only 101 nodes. But at a later point, say 150 nodes or 200 nodes are coming, and they are also ready to host the nodes. But you can't consider them. That is a problem. Or how you are going to consider them? Then we can't take the advantage of all of them. So we are not getting a pure even distribution. On the other hand, if we select a number larger than the largest possible number of nodes, that means initially, you know, there are only 101 machines, but in future, there may be, say, 200 machines will come. That you are sure about it. But accordingly, you are saying that instead of taking modulo 101, you are going to take modulo 200. Okay, fine. But at the initial phase itself, when you are taking modulo 200, you will be getting values from 0 to 199. But for the time being, you are having only 101 addresses, right? So what you are going to do with the values greater than 101? So that is the issue. So that initial estimation is something important here. And it's a kind of static allocation. You can't make the nodes dynamically come and go, okay? That is the problem we are facing. So then there will be some values of x that will not hash into the address for a node that does not exist. There will have some value of x that will hash to a address that is not existing. So there is also the not so small issue of translating the value returned by the hash function into an actual IP address. I told you what is a hash function is giving you, and that value you have to convert into an IP address also. That is an additional effort. Then only you can make it a valid address. So similarly, when you are searching an information also, you have to take the hash value. And again, there is one more step of converting that hash value into an IP address and how you are going to do it. Okay, you can think of it, but still that is also adding an additional overhead here. So that about problem with a straightforward hashing. To overcome this problem, we have a concept called a consistent hashing. Let's see how it is working. To address the issues of the straightforward hashing that we seen so far, the structured P2P network uses an algorithm known as consistent hashing, which hashes a set of object X uniformly across a large ID space. Okay, so here in the previous case, our ID space is restricted to that 101 values, like that initial estimate. But here there is no such problem. We are going to take a very large ID space, and to that ID space we are going to map the object as well as the node. We will see how it is working.
Here you can see a typical example of 128-bit ID space is shown in the figure. So using 128 bits, how many combinations are possible? That is 0 to 2 raised to 128 minus 1. So that many possibilities are making your ID space. Okay. Now, given an order, you will apply hash function and you will map that node into a particular hash value. And the object ID also you are going to map into a hash value, and there will be some kind of correlation between them. So that is the idea. So the figure visualizes an 128-bit ID space having values from 0 to 2 raised to 128 minus 1 as a circle. This is a typical example. You can think of a smaller value, a 64-bit ID space also. Like that, anything you can think of. As you are taking more value, more even distribution, everything you can assume you will be getting. Where we use an algorithm to place both the objects and the nodes. So that is the idea. Here we are going to apply hash function for objects and nodes. That means hash of an object in I. That is the some kind of ID of the object which is to be hosted in a given machine. You are going to take a hash of it. And you are taking the IP address of individual machine and you are taking its hash also. And both will return some value. And see, in the previous case, from that node ID, just like this object ID you are getting initially, and that you are converting it into this IP address. But here, instead of that, both object name and the IP address together, we are taking the hash. And there is no other step. Okay. Now, what is the desirable thing? If both are mapping to a same value, both can be mapped into a single value, means this particular object is getting stored into this particular IP address. But the possibility of getting this hash value and this hash value as same is somewhat rare, because we are considering a large ID space. This can give you, depending on the kind of hash value, which hash function you are using. If we are using some efficient hash function, you can get somewhat similarity, but still in general we are getting two different values only. Now these values we have to link each other, okay? So that is a difficulty here. So when it comes to constant version, so since a 128 ID space is enormous, it is unlikely that an object will hash to exactly the same ID as a machine's IP address hash to. That is what I told you. As it is a very big ID space, you can't expect that both the object and the node address are going to hash to the same value. Then it is very straightforward, but that is not possible in a typical bigger ID space like 128 bit. To account for this unlikelihood, each node is maintained on the each object is maintained on the node whose ID is closest. That is the only way we can do. We can't make both of them equal. Then it is straightforward. Simply you can put it there. But as we are not able to make both the values together, we are just looking at the proximity. And a particular object, you take the hash value. Node also, the IP address of the machine also, you take the hash value. And just compare the hash value. Object hash value should be close to the node hash value, which is more maximum closest to that object hash value. To that particular machine, you will be hosting the object. So that is it. We will see an example, then it will be clear. So in this 128 database, to the object ID. In other words, the idea is to use a high quality hash function to map both the nodes and object in I into the same large sparse ID space. You then map objects to nodes by numerical proximity of their respective identifiers. So that numerical proximity you are taking care. So like ordinary hashing, this distributes object fairly evenly across nodes, but unlike ordinary hashing, only a small number of objects have to move when a node joins or leaves a network. That also we will see. When an example is taken, this part will be clear. Just like in the previous example, whenever a new node is joining, definitely you have to change the hash function accordingly. And also when someone is leaving, again a lot of overhead is there, and such things are not here. Here the movements are very small compared to the other normal traditional hashing. See how a request is routed here.
How does so assume that in that 128 bit ID space we mapped both object and the node, and we kept that object into a node whose hash value and the object hash value are of close proximity, are nearby. And in such a on already mapped the network, we are looking at the routing of a request, how a new request is routed. And now the thing is that you should do an efficient searching also. It should not go in a random way. It should be located very fast. So that is the ultimate idea of structured B2B, and that should happen. So how does a user that wants to access an object X know which node is closest to X ID in the space? How it is going to locate it? We know we are taking the hash value of the object ID, and we are going to keep that particular object into that IP particular machine with IP address whose hash value is closest to the object hash value. And now while locating that particular object, you can take that hash value. Now just by taking that hash value, how we are going to locate the node which is hosting that particular object. One possible approach is that each node keeps a complete table of node ID and their associated IP address. So definitely it's not going to work, because that will be a bigger mapping, but this would not be a practical for a large network. So that is a direct approach, but as the network is scaling, this is not going to work. The alternative, which is the approach used by typical structured peer-to-peer network, is to route a message to the node that is close to the node containing the object. As of now, I don't know where it is. So what I can do is I will try to forward the message into a node which is closer to the actual destination. So like that, so we will see how that is achieved. So like that, we will try to reach the actual destination with minimum number of hops. We are not doing any query flooding, nothing. It's a straightforward approach only. So in other words, if you construct the overlay in a clever way, that construction matters, which is the same as saying that we need to choose entries of for a node's routing table in a clever way. Then we can find a node simply by routing toward it. So we are trying to reach that node. In that way we are routing. Okay, we know that where it is. Accordingly, in a very focused way, we are doing that routing. Collectively, this approach is sometimes called a distributed hash table. Okay, from traditional hashing, consistent hashing, and that itself, how we are doing that routing of the request. If you are following this approach, this is particularly called a distributed hash technique. Since conceptually, the hash table is distributed over the nodes in the network, just like the hash table we are keeping in a centralized machine. Here we can see a kind of, actually hash table is not getting distributed, but still we are getting the feel of a hash table get distributed over the network. In that way it is working. We will take an example, then this part will be clear. So suppose we are at the node, just look at the figure. Right now we are at the node with the ID, this 65A1FC. Hexadecimal value, and we are trying to locate an object with the ID, say D4 6A1C. So this is the hash value I am getting for the object, and I don't know about other machines that are available in the P2P. Right now, this particular peer want to locate an object. So this particular machine is generating the request query message for the particular resource. And it take the object ID of the resource, maybe the file ID something, and it generate the hash value. And see, there is no relation between this hash value and the hash. There's everything shown here is a hash value. Okay, the machine's IP address is taken and its hash value is noted here. And it want to locate an object, its object ID is taken and its hash value is this. And when these two hash values are compared, there is no correlation at all. So what it will do, we realize that our ID shares nothing with the objects. So there is no hope that I will be containing it, or some of my nearby neighbors are containing it. But I know a node that shares at least the prefix D. So this is the idea. We will look at the prefix, prefix of the object hash value. So here it is D. So I will try to find, I will look at all my neighbors, which means neighbor in the sense, not a physical neighbor, with respect to that overlay structure, with who are all my neighbor, and I will see the hash value of their IP address. And is there any match with the hash value of the object, prefix match? So here I know, suppose that this machine is having a neighbor. This is having a neighbor, A and B knows each other, then there will be an edge. That's that kind of a neighbor relation with this machine. It may be having more than many other neighbors also, but see, this neighbor, the speciality is its IP address. The prefix is getting matched, right? That D part alone is matched, but still I don't know that it will be here or not. Okay, so what I will do is I will forward that request to him, saying that this is to be resolved further. And what it will do is it will be having many neighbors, and how that neighbor is constructed is that intelligent part of the overlay construction, that is what we mentioned. Then only you can do this like that. So that part is not explained here. We are looking at the routing part only. So when he is getting it, see object ID, this D. So already D match, the prefix D is matched. Then I will see, is there any machine with the match D and 4 together. So I am having such a neighbor, I will be forwarding here. Then I will be getting a match from D, 4 and 6. So I will look at all my neighbors and who is having such a match, I will be forwarding the request to him. D, 4, 6 further, D, 4, 6, A. See, when I'm trying for D46A, I am not getting, but instead I'm getting D467 as a neighbor. See, so I can forward to him, that means at least D46 is matched, but the next part, that is 7, here there is no match. So even at this point, if I'm looking at all my neighbors, see, none of them is having at least this D46, that much prefix match is not there for any of my neighbor. Say, the very next one is having a value D47. So what does it mean? Here, at this point, I'm not getting the match, getting any match. That means the object which I am looking for will be available in this particular machine, like D471, not this one, this one. So what is the idea we used for hosting an object into a particular machine? We are looking at the IP address, hash value of the IP address and the hash value of the object ID, and which are having a very close match in terms of that bitwise match. It's just, even though it is shown like that, assume that it's an 128-bit value, which is maximum near to my value. With that close proximity, I am placing it. So it will be there in this particular machine. So like that, at this point, I am stopping and I will be returning address of this particular machine, as it is saying that this is having that particular machine, particular object. So we realize that our ID shares nothing but this one. So that node is closer than us in the 128-bit ID. So we forward the message to it. So we keep on doing that. So assume that the node D13DA, this node, knows of another node that shares an even longer prefix with this particular object, it forwards a message on. And this process of moving closer in ID space continues until we reach a node that knows of no closer node. So that is at this point we are stopping. This node will be the one that hosts the object. That is what I told you, because with that close proximity of object ID and IP address, we are placing the object into a particular node. So here, this node is not knowing any other neighbor with a longer prefix or somewhat equal prefix. So this will be the one who is hosting this particular information. So this is how this algorithm is routing a typical request. And see, it is not flooding and there is no exponential time consumed or nothing. But the construction itself, I just given you an overview only, but inside there are many more details, including how this overlay is constructed. That part is skipped here. You may be having certain doubts, that is because that part is not clear. But anyway, that much detail is not needed as far as the syllabus is concerned. So I am stopping here. Okay, so there will be one more part for this session, that will be where we will discuss on that BitTorrent as another case study. Okay, hope somewhat clear for you. Thank you.